Hi, I'm Jay from Real Street Performance. Today we're going to talk about some common wiring problems and how to avoid them. The problem areas that we're going to discuss are the connections, the wire size, the relays, and the fuses. I avoid using the insulated connectors because it's a split barrel clamp, and when you clamp it down, it's liable to open up instead of crimp around the wire completely. Instead, I like to use the full barrel connector. If crimped correctly, it totally encapsulates the wire so the wire cannot pull out. If I am going to use a split end where it can open up around the wire, then I'll crimp the wire and then I'll heat it up and melt some solder into it and then use some heat shrink. Because the isolated connector doesn't give you the visual of seeing how the connection is actually made, you can have a problem with an isolated connector just because you've used it incorrectly. They can work, but it's easier to use the materials that I'm going to talk about today to make sure that you have 100% good connections throughout your system. When using a non-insulated full barrel connector, you can be sure that the connection is made 100%. Once you're done checking to make sure that you're crimped correctly, you can slide some heat shrink over it to isolate it from the other wires and to seal it from the weather. Another common problem area is when you have to pin your own connectors. If you're installing a different style map sensor or a different set of injectors, you may need to change the connector end. There's a special type of pliers that is used to crimp these types of connectors, and it swedges the wire down in between both sides of the connector to make sure that they've made a very good contact. If you prefer soldering, you should follow these steps to keep you out of trouble. Strip off about 1/4 inch of the wire sheathing, open the wire up in the shape of a V, join it together with its mating wire, twist the two together, heat the wire with the soldering iron, not the solder. As the wire reaches the proper temperature, the solder will melt in through the wire and you won't have this globby mess of solder when you're done. Then you can slide your heat shrink over it. It should look like this when you're done. In respect to keeping the tech tips short in a manageable amount of time, we're not going to go much into wire size. You need to understand the current or amperage draw that the device you're wiring into the car uses, and then you can Google around and find what size wire you need to be using. If you use a small wire on a large device, you're going to have a large problem. So avoid that by just understanding how much energy the component needs and then feeding it with the appropriate size wire. I recommend that you're using fuses to isolate your aftermarket device from your factory system. This is a very simple way to avoid creating problems for your factory vehicle. Put the fuse near the power source and not near the device. If you short the wire out and the power source is at the front of the car and the device is at the back of the car with the fuse, that length of wire is going to be cooking, versus if you have a problem with the wiring and the fuse blows at the power source, the whole device, the whole wiring and all of it is protected by that fuse circuit. So make sure that the fuse is near the power source. I recommend that you're using a relay for any of your larger devices such as cooling fans, nitrous kit, fuel pump. The relay is not complicated to wire in. There's generally 4 pins that you're going to be concerned about. 30 will be a fused 12-volt source. 87 will be the output going to the device. 85 will be a ground. It could go to a clean chassis ground, a battery ground, or a switch ground via your aftermarket ECU or hob switch. And the switched 12 volts is going to go to the 86 pin. Switched 12 volts means, guys, that it's only key on power. If you wire up something to an aftermarket ECU or an aftermarket system where the 30 pin and 86 pin both have power all the time, you're going to make for some strange problems for yourself. So do yourself a favor, make sure switch 12 volts is indeed switch 12 volts on the 86 pin. I've seen way too many wiring mistakes to cover in one video. These are just some of the common mistakes I see come through the shop, and I'd like to help you avoid them. Hopefully seeing them here will prevent you from running into the same problems that other people did. Thanks and have a good week.